Next, let's discuss the murder of Haman Lee and the potential innocence of Adnan Syed, the man behind bars for her murder. I'm going to be doing a pretty big series on this one because, one, there's a lot of information, and two, I have a lot of opinions. This is Haman Lee. She was a Korean-American student at Woodlawn High School in Baltimore, Maryland. She was in the magnet program, and she was also an athlete. January 13, 1999, Haman Lee was reported missing by her family after failing to pick up her younger cousin from elementary school. People did see her leaving the high school, so they weren't sure where she went after that. Baltimore police started working immediately trying to figure out where she went. To get more information, they made a few calls, one of them being to her ex-boyfriend Adnan Syed, who said he saw her around lunch period, but that was it. They also called her current boyfriend Don, who said he hadn't seen her at all that day. Dogs walked along the property to see if they could pick up a scent. It wasn't until February 9th, 1999, that a passerby would find a shallow grave at Lincoln Park. On February 9th, 1999, Alonzo Sellers called police. He stopped by Lincoln Park to take a quick pee break when he discovered a very shallow grave and potentially a body in the park. Investigators soon discovered that this was missing Haman Lee. In further parts, I'm going to go more into detail about her body. Police immediately declared this a homicide and got to work right away. Only a few days later, February 12th, 1999, police received an anonymous phone call saying that they should look into the ex-boyfriend, Adnan Syed. We aren't entirely sure who made this call. However, the couple did date most of 1998. They kept it kind of a secret though because of their religious backgrounds, but they did break up later in the year, and that's when Haman Lee started dating Don. February 16th, 1999, police obtained cell phone records of the phone that belonged to Adnan Syed. February 28th, Adnan was arrested and charged with first-degree murder of Haman Lee. Why were they so quick to arrest Adnan? Police were relying heavily on the testament his best friend gave. So I do stand corrected. In my last video, I said that this was Adnan's best friend, but people were saying in the comments that they were just kind of acquaintances who would smoke weed together occasionally. This is Jay Wilds, and he became the state's primary witness. So this is something I'll kind of discuss later, but I printed this out because it contained Jay's original testimony. This is the Court of Special Appeals of Maryland, Adnan Syed versus the State of Maryland, March 19th, 2003. So this is later down the road. I'll mention more of this later. But according to Jay, he called Adnan Syed in the morning of January 13th, saying that he needed to buy a present for his girlfriend, so they went to the mall together. Then eventually the two went back to school, where allegedly they had a conversation about Haman Lee, and Adnan said it wasn't going well. Kind of confused by this because I thought that they had broken up by this point. According to Jay, Haman Lee told Adnan that she was making him mad, and Adnan apparently said, "I'm going to kill that bitch." And apparently after this, Adnan let Jay borrow his phone, his car. When they met up later, Adnan asked if he was ready to do this.
On March 23rd, 1993, at around 8 p.m., college freshman Trisha Reitler was writing a term paper when she got tired, and she decided to go to the nearby Marsh supermarket. This was pretty much a normal night. There were 7 to 8 guys playing basketball. There was a family with their baby playing in a park. Everything seemed pretty normal. According to the Charlie Project, Trisha bought a diet soda and a magazine, and she started making her way back to the dorms, but sadly, she never made it. She was reported as missing, and a search party immediately began. They even brought in search dogs, but because she had been running that day, her scent was everywhere. Her receipt from the supermarket was found next to a road, and sadly, 3 days later, her clothes were found. 3 days after 19-year-old Trisha Reitler goes missing. According to the 27 Unsolved documentary on this case, her clothes were found in a kind of wooded open area that had a lot of traffic nearby. Her clothes were found bloody, and her jeans had grass stains on them. Sadly, there would be nothing else found of Trisha. And to this day, it is unknown what happened to her. Even though there seemed to be a lot of movement in the last place she was seen, no witnesses came forward. There was a family that was playing at a nearby park, and the dad was filming the baby, and he actually handed police what he recorded to see if they could find anything. They were able to confirm that there were guys playing basketball, but they were never identified, and they never came forward with any information. There were also no signs as to what could have happened to Trisha. In the disappearance of Trisha Reitler, there were 3 possible suspects. In 1999, Donald Greener was arrested and charged for kidnapping and sexual assault of a young girl in Marion, Indiana. According to the Charlie Project, his home was searched for any evidence tying him to Trisha's disappearance, as well as the disappearance of another young woman named Wendy Felton. But nothing was found. According to the 27 Unsolved documentary, there was another man named Tony Searcy who was a suspect in Trisha's disappearance. According to the documentary, they say that he kept interjecting himself into the investigation. To police, this is a red flag. If you watch Criminal Minds, you know that there is a trait that some perpetrators have where they will insert themselves in a case to see how much police knows. And the third suspect is Larry Hall. Larry Hall was the last suspect in the Trisha Reitler disappearance. A few months after Trisha went missing, authorities found newspaper clippings as well as maps that seemed to be connected to Trisha's case in Larry's van. According to the Charlie Project, he was arrested in 1994 for the kidnapping and murder of Jessica Roach. Larry Hall confessed to doing the same thing to Trisha. He claims that her remains were buried in a reservoir, but they were never found, and there was never enough evidence to convict him. After 27 years, this case remains open, and there has been no new information. All her family asks is that we continue to spread awareness on her case, and they hope that new eyes come into the investigation to try to solve what happened to Trisha. I send her family and her loved ones so much love and light. Hey, welcome to your daily true crime minisode. In 1993, 19-year-old Trisha Reitler was a freshman at Wesleyan University in Marion, Indiana. She was studying psychology and her goal was to become a family counselor to be able to help broken families get back together. This really defined who Trisha was as a person. She was someone who's very driven, very loving, caring, and she was very smart. She was attending the university on a scholarship and she was getting really good grades. On the day of March 23, 1993, it started off as any other day. It was such a beautiful day and she decided to go running twice. Later on that day, she settled down into her dorm and started writing a term paper when she got really tired and decided to go to a Marsh supermarket that was near the campus. Sadly, this would be the last time Trisha would be seen.
Calling all true crime fans. If you're interested in true crime at all, I am sure you've heard of the JonBenet Ramsey case, and I'm sure you also have your own theory about what happened. Let's continue discussing crimes that happened around Christmas. Now, I'll give you a little recap if you don't know who this is at all. This is JonBenet Ramsey. She was born in 1990 in Atlanta, Georgia. She was the youngest of two. This is her brother, Burke. Put a pin in him. Oddly enough, JonBenet's name was created from her dad's first and middle name. Now, it's to be noted that they did not live in Georgia when this happened. This happened in Colorado. JonBenet was raised in the spotlight of beauty pageants. Everything was fine until Christmas 1996, when a very strange 911 call came through.
What's going on, Emma? We were kidnapped. Hurry, please explain to me what's going on, okay?
There's a note left and our daughter's gone.
Now let's recap that 911 call. Patsy Ramsey here said that there's been a kidnapping and a note was left and their daughter is gone. The ransom note was found on the kitchen staircase demanding about $118,000, which today is about $200,000. This dollar amount is extremely important, so put a pin in that as well. Now of course word got out to friends and family that something happened to JonBenet and she was gone. And because of this, people wanted to show their support. So friends, family, the family minister, everybody came to the house. They helped clean up, you know, surfaces, the kitchen, destroying literally all traces of evidence in the house. However, there were zero attempts to not let this happen by law enforcement. The ransom note noted that there was a time limit, but no one actually came forward wanting the money. Everything so far is pretty fishy about this. Around 1 p.m., they continued searching the house and found JonBenet's body in the basement. JonBenet's father, John, picked her up and brought her upstairs, which further destroyed evidence. Her mouth was covered with duct tape, she was tied up and bound. JonBenet's autopsy results said that she had died from asphyxia by strangulation, along with craniocerebral trauma, so strangulation and a skull fracture. It's also very important to note that her stomach contained pineapple, and in the Ramsey kitchen, there was a bowl of pineapple sitting on the counter, which no one remembers putting there. There was also part of a paintbrush that was used in the nylon around JonBenet's neck. Guess who was a painter? And it matched the other art supplies. Patsy Ramsey. Now, the whole Ramsey family gave blood samples for DNA testing. They were very cooperative. By October 1997, police had 1,600 people on their radar as potential persons of interest for the case. There's a lot of amazing information and documentaries out there that cover this case. So for the next part, let's discuss theory. So there was a lot of people that could have done this. Let's discuss theories. Let's start with the mother, Patsy Ramsey. Patsy here was your typical suburban mom, former beauty queen. Now, Patsy was cleared of the crime along with her husband, although she did die in 2008 from ovarian cancer, so we'll never know anything more than she said. Now, if you recall the ransom note that I mentioned earlier, there was an analysis done on the handwriting to see if it matched Patsy's, and it did not. However, the paper that was used and the pen were items that were originally found in the Ramsey house, stuff that did belong to Patsy. It was said that Patsy got pretty upset with JonBenet over her bedwetting, and there are theories that she just got extremely angry with JonBenet. Now, to quickly focus on the father, John Ramsey. John was the one that was kind of coordinating the investigation at first before the police arrived, so it's kind of suspicious because he seemed to be covering up evidence, potentially. Also, if you remember, the ransom note requested $118,000. John pointed out that this was exactly the amount that he had gotten for a Christmas bonus, but only a few people knew that, including John. He was also cleared of the crime. Moving on to different suspects. Now, this creepy son of a bitch is Gary Oliva. I believe that's how you say his last name. He was a convicted pedophile living in the Colorado area when this occurred. Now, the autopsy results could not rule out sexual assault to JonBenet. There was just the tiniest trace of blood on her underwear. Police did find a cutout of JonBenet Ramsey in this guy's backpack. Gary here also apparently confessed to his longtime friend that he hurt a little girl. Not really specifying who, but he was also cleared after DNA testing. There was also a theory that it was their electrician, Michael Helgoth, because of a boot print that matched a boot that he owned. Michael, though, did commit suicide right before the press conference in 97, but also his DNA was cleared as well. Her school teacher, John Mark Carr, confessed out of the blue, but again was cleared because of DNA. Like I said earlier, there was a lot of people that could have done this. However, let's move on to my favorite theory, Burke Ramsey, the brother. Please remember this is all alleged, but I have very strong feelings about this one. Burke Ramsey here apparently did have some anger issues. According to the Ramsey housekeeper, Burke here apparently used to spread feces around her room when he was upset with her. Also to point out, during a golf game, he got so angry with JonBenet, he actually hit her across the head with the club. Now, during the investigation, they did find a flashlight near the pineapple bowl. Also, this incredibly weird piece of evidence from the 911 call. See, when Patsy here placed the 911 call, apparently she thought she hung up the phone. She did not, and the operator kept listening. Once people analyze the audio a little bit further, you can hear what sounds like a conversation happening in the back. What do you think happened to JonBenet Ramsey? Let me know.
Today we're going to be talking about the disappearance of Walter Collins. It is March 10th of 1928. This 9-year-old boy went to see a movie and he never returned. Now, the mom reported his son missing 5 days later, which is really odd and interesting, but it isn't discussed much. The LAPD, which is theorized to be pretty corrupt, actually just ruled it a runaway. When the case began to pick up media attention, the LAPD was really just trying to close the case. Now, in August of that same year, a runaway boy was found, and he claimed that he was Walter Collins. Now, this boy doesn't really look like the Walter Collins that went missing, but the LAPD was really trying to close the case, and so even though this boy really didn't know some interesting details and his story really didn't add up, they told the mother that this was her son. When she first saw him, she said, "That's not my boy." But the police were very insistent. 3 weeks later, she had dental records that showed it wasn't her son. Part two is up. Now, this boy who claimed to be Walter Collins was 1 inch shorter than him, and the dental records did not match. The only reason it took the mother 3 weeks to finally get all this together is because the police kept insisting that this was her son and that she needed to try him out. The LAPD went as far as to put her in a psych ward for saying that that wasn't her son. Now later, the boy came out, his actual name is Arthur Hudgens, and the man who put her in the psych ward was actually fired, but then reinstated. She did sue him and won. However, he didn't actually pay the money that he owed her. So he did get his job back. He didn't have to pay her, even though the court ruled he had to pay her. Is LAPD really corrupt? I don't know, you tell me. Anyways, Walter's dad, who was in jail at the time, was kind of known for snitching in jail, so he thought maybe one of his enemies or former inmates had kidnapped his son. That didn't really hold up. However, this next theory, which has the most evidence, is pretty interesting. 3 months prior to Collins' disappearance, 12-year-old Marion Parker had been adopted. The theory is that he was actually kidnapped by Gordon Northcott. He owned a chicken farm and was actually being looked into due to immigration issues. His sister, who was in Canada, allowed her son to come live with him, and he reportedly sexually and physically abused him. In 1948, the sister found out, and when she called authorities, Northcott and his mother fled. When police had arrived to the farm, they were gone. Now, they noticed the farm grounds were actually soaked with blood, and there was a lot of articles of clothing, specifically of boys. And certain items or toys. A lot of those items of clothing were identified with missing children. Sanford, which is Gordon Norcott's nephew that he abused, actually identified Walter Collins as well as other boys. Gordon Northcott was arrested in September 20th. He confessed about 9 boys, but was only charged with 3 murders because there was insufficient evidence. He did still receive life in prison. However, he later recanted his confession stating that he didn't even know Walter. Regardless, Walter Collins' case is unsolved.
On July 15, 1982, cemetery workers in Blairstown, New Jersey uncovered a body at the Cedar Ridge Cemetery. She was a young girl who was between the ages of 14 and 18 and had been dead for several days. Her injuries were unfathomably brutal. She had been beaten and her face was unrecognizable. She was wearing a red sweater, a wrap skirt, and cross jewelry with a double pierced ear. Earning the nickname Princess Doe, her story caught the attention of HBO and also inspired the novel Death Among Strangers. Unfortunately, the attention did not bring the case closer to closure, and her identity is still a mystery. A man in prison for other crimes once came forward as her killer, but inconsistencies in his story failed to convict him. One woman made claims that she was her daughter, but dental records were not a match. Furthering the pain caused by her death, her gravesite has been the target of vandals, but her epitaph prevails. Princess Doe, dead among strangers, remembered by all.